you could get any character in any order, so because of that, it's like...
I mean, literally the only characters that are mandatory in World of Ruin is Celis, obviously, because you are her. She's the main character of World of Ruin, and then you need Setzer for the airship. That's it.
Wow, so you literally can beat the game without Lock and Terra.
I mean, you need more than two characters, because you need three groups for, what's his name's, tower. Kepko's tower.
I wish there were more RPGs that did that, because that one's like, everything is so messed up that it's literally like, after, you know, an A-bomb goes off and you're like, picking up the pieces and stuff. That's really cool.
I mean, Kepko got everything he wanted.
Friggin' Kepko. That freaking laugh. Yeah, it's probably 7 or 3. I can't think of any others. Almost every character from 7 is enjoyable enough. I think my least favorite would be Tifa. Well,
I think Tifa.
I guess Tifa would be the least favorite though, because Cid is incredible. Red 13. I would say Red 13 is the least enjoyable.
Kate Sith
is quite enjoyable, especially with the whole like. Big reveal at the end, and I really like Yuffie, and I really like Barret, and I really like Eris.
Before they
changed her, you know, for Advent Children. So I guess it would be Vincent and Red 13 are the only not good characters.
Vincent would be my least favorite.
Yeah, Vincent's probably least favorite.
Yeah.
Like Red 13's alright, he's just kinda like duty bound.
Which is fine, not every character can be like Yuffie. I think Cid has to be best, though.
And that's the best Cid.
Definitely. The second best, though, is the 8th Cid. I really like Headmaster Cid.
Even though he's a coward.
Yeah. Cid from 6 is cool, too. I think he's one of the airship guys, right?
I don't remember, honestly.
I forget.
Yeah, I'm gonna throw something controversial out there, and I'm gonna say I like Final Fantasy VIII's characters. I think they're a little more.
They're
grounded.
Way too underutilized.
I definitely agree with that. Like, you have a character like Irvine, right? Who's like pretty interesting, right? And you get him right before you do that like sniping mission, right?
Right.
And there's this huge thing about like, can I do it? And he can't, right? And then after that, it's like he might as well not even exist. There's like nothing.
I mean, none of the characters
so
do
I,
anything after.
I guess I, the little character. That exists.
I think
good.
I think the most underutilized character I've ever seen with the best like opportunity to be very good is Quistis. Quistis, when you're Quistis and Squall, you're like, oh, Quistis is like super young, but she's like one of the best like teachers, and she like can handle Squall's stupidness, you know, all this stuff, whatever. And it's like, after you get past, like, the gardens and stuff like that, she, like, doesn't exist. After you become, like, a seed or, like,
every
after that stuff.
Stops existing.
Rinoa is, like, a legitimately, like, not great character. She, like, just doesn't have much to her.
Yeah.
Squall, I like him just because, like, you play as him and stuff, but he's also, like,
let me characterize
completely unlocked.
Okay. This one. I do not like Squall. I do not like Squall. I'm actually in love with Cypher. And I use Squall to get at Cypher. Diz 2. Oh, I like Squall now for no reason. For literally no reason. Who's Cypher? Okay, that's Rinoa.
And the only character that I really like from it is Zell, but he's pretty one-dimensional in that he's just like... Can't control his temper and is like the comic relief. So, I like 8, and I think 8 has a really interesting storyline, but... Man, those characters are really underutilized.
It is
8 is such an interesting
Interesting
game.
Is, like, the kindest way to say it.
It's just super interesting.
It is, like, very poorly written. But I also like it. Like, Final Fantasy VIII is good. I like
it. That's one of those games that you can talk bad about it for, like, an hour, and then be like, but I like it. Like, that doesn't happen too often.
I mean, here's a good thing about Final Fantasy VIII. Amazing side quests.
The side quests are
battle
incredible.
Battle system that might be exploitable, but is fun. The best animations of, like, any game. Like, I think...
I like the exploration, too, like, on the map and stuff like that. Really cool. I also like... Okay. So the story for FF8, you have to categorize into two things. The first one is when Ida is the bad guy, and the second is after. When Ida is the bad guy, and you're doing the whole gardens thing, and, like, you know, Galbadia Garden fights you, and you're, like, earning your seed, is, like, incredible. But then after, like, Ida becomes, like, a good guy, it, like, is just terrible. Like, before you even, like, go to Ultimecia's and everything, it's, like,
sources
just bad.
From the future.
But legitimately, the first half is, like, I just love it. Like, I love that whole, like,
this one is good.
Warring factions and the fact that you have, like, you're, like, starting at the bottom and earning your way up through the garden. And I love the gardens. Oh, another thing that FF8 has, but probably the only game with better one is FF7 is a soundtrack. FF8 soundtrack's awesome. It's
yeah,
so good.
Definitely.
It might be my favorite.
It might even be better, honestly. FF7 has more, like, completely memorable ones, but I've also played that game a lot more. FF8 is a comfy soundtrack, but, man, it's weird. It's like, I don't know, it's like they fired the staff who wrote the first part of the game and were like, all right, we need to finish this. And then, like, the new staff was like,
SquallDies.com.
SquallIsDead.com. I don't know.
I mean, that's obviously not what they meant to do, but it's the only way to make the game make sense.
Yeah. It is weird how, like, somebody can come up with something like that, and you're like, you know, this all makes sense. It's not what they meant, because that would be ridiculous, but it's pretty cool. Yeah, I like games like that, where you can just, like, talk bad on them for, like, 10 minutes, and then be like, yeah, but I like it. Like, every horror game ever. Like, Mush the other day was, he got Resident Evil, the Origins Collection. It's the remakes of 1 and 0.
Oh, yeah.
And he was talking about, like, 0. He was like, yeah, I got, like, 20 minutes into 0. And it's just like, I don't know, it's hard to control. Like, I wish there weren't, like, tank controls. And I'm like, Mush, the second you have a horror game, and it's, like, super, super easy to control, and, like, super fluid, it's not a horror game. It's, like, an action game or an adventure game.
Like, Resident Evil is pretty much already an action game.
Part of, like, what makes horror games is, like, there's a struggle, you know? So it's like, that's why something like Dead Space might be a scary game, but it's not a horror game, because it's very easy to just get around and do what you need to do. So, like, Silent Hill 1, I love, but I don't want to play it that often because it's, like, very taxing and very, like, honestly annoying. But that's part of a horror game, you know? Like, you watch a horror movie and you're, like, constantly agitated because you're like, oh, why are they doing this? You know, why is this happening? You know, whatever, I would do it this way. It's like, it's kind of how the horror game is, you know?
So, you would say, like, the defining, like, criteria between action and horror would be that feeling of, like,
uneasiness. Well, of what? Hopefully, yeah, I think that's a good one.
It's, so, like, because when you watch a horror movie, like, you,
like,
feel helpless to control it because, like, obviously it's a movie, and the fact that this person is very slowly, like, walking past the closet where,
yeah,
you know, Jason is hiding in her or something. I don't watch a lot of horror movies, but, like,
I don't want to say yeah, a horror game can't have good controls,
yeah,
but it can't give you too many options. Like, say they made a game like Clock Tower, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where, like, you're not able to fight back, but it was very, like, easily controlled. That's a horror game. But it's not, yeah, like you can just walk in and be like... Like, Doom is not a horror game, right? Because you have
by
a...
No.
Right. Doom's, like, more of, like, an action game. And
games don't have to take, like, super strides of being unplayable, like, Underground. Like, that's the point where it's like, this is just not fun. I'm not finishing this game.
Yeah. But it could be, like, I don't know, even something like Fatal Frame isn't, like, bad controls. It's just, like, not unbelievably, like, easy, and there's always that, like, tension. So, I don't know, it's like, I still think that remake on GameCube is, like, definitely one of the best horror games ever made, and a reason I can say that is I don't want to play it that often. Like, if there's a horror game where I just want to pop it in every day, it's like, then it's not a good horror game, you know? because it hasn't done what it set out to do, which is just, like, make me scared and, like, whatever all the time. And, like, just thinking about Resident Evil 1 and having to deal with, like, the Crimson Heads, and then there's, like, Lisa Spencer, I think her name is, and all that, and it's like, oh, God. Like, every moment of that game, I'm like, oh, I just don't want to do it. But it's so good that you're like, okay, I'll do it, you know?
So, welcome to Twilight Princess Part 5, where we speak about every other game.
I am completely fine about talking about anything else, because it's dungeon boring.
I do want to say that, I mean, this is a boring dungeon, and yet the most unique.
It is pretty unique.
As far as setting goes. But,
Do those guys, the guy who was making soup, like, live in this house, but it's just, like, a broken-down house?
He got one of the pieces of the Twilight beer and he's just messing up everything. His wife got sick, which is why he's making soup. And, all these monsters are, like, whatever.
So I do want to say that, I do feel deeply disturbed, when you use the... What is that weapon called?
The ball and chain.
The ball and chain. When you use it to hit like a platform, I feel like the platform should move more because it is being hit by a big ball and chain, and it just kind of slowly swings.
Shaking my head.
And that has been bothering me.
Whoa!
I want to feel that oomph. Like that one.
This is an interesting mechanic, but it's, like, straight. I can see this being one of those dungeons where you're like, oh my god, with these, like, balls and everything.
Because, like, this dungeon just shattered that, like, ice wall, right? Just, like, so easy. And
yo,
that platform...
Here's a question of the part that is Zelda-related. Here's a question of the part that is Zelda-related. What is your favorite or best, like, Zelda dungeon in any Zelda game? Let's make it a little easier and say 3D only, so not like Link's Awakening or Link to the Past or whatever. So I guess it would be like Ocarina, Majora, Wind Waker, Twilight Princess, probably not Skyward Sword, but I don't know.
I really like Forest Temple and Ocarina of Time.
It's very unique in that it has all that like weird like...
Has a really cool boss, has four cool sub-bosses that directly correlate to your progress.
You know which one I always like, even though it gives me a lot of trouble every time, is the Goron / Ice one in Majora's Mask, the one that's pretty much just built in a big pillar, and you have to like knock out all the stuff and beat a Goron. I find that to be super fun.
Yeah, that's a pretty cool dungeon.
Oh, and there's also the Sand one in Ocarina is super cool. I like it.
What's gonna happen?
I think I just like Dodongo's Cavern.
From
Ocarina, yeah.
You know, it's easy to hate on Ocarina, but it does have some pretty good and decent dungeons.
But the water temple.
None of them are... It's weird. I don't think any of them are quite as big as some of the dungeons in, like, Twilight Princess. Like, some of them in Twilight Princess seem to go just on forever.
I mean, Majora's Mask has the biggest dungeons of
all.
But Twilight Princess... I mean, Majora's Mask also only has four. Twilight Princess are slow-paced. Oh, yeah, I forgot. Yeah, do all these guys.
I guess that's why it feels like they go on, because they're just, like, slower-paced. I think my least favorite, despite being from my favorite game, just because it's very unique, but I always mess it up, is it's the seventh one in Link's Awakening. It's called Something Tower. It's the one where you have to throw that ball to break those like pillars. I always like find a way to mess it up or to forget what's going on because you have to knock down those four pillars to bring the tower down.
I wasn't listening. What game?
Oh, Link's Awakening, the tower one where you have to throw the ball to knock down the pillars. I always have such a hard time with that one.
I'm trying to think. I like almost every single dungeon out of Link to the Past.
I think the only one I don't like in Link to the Past is the first one in the Dark World. I'm just not a huge fan of it.
It's kind of confusing, but...
Yeah. The, you know, pretty underrated temple is the, the village one from Dark World of Link to the Past. Especially the part where you have to let the light in to the boss room is really, really cool. That game is just awesome. Do you have to follow her?
No. Thank God.
Oh my God.
It would take actually 5 minutes.
You know, nowadays this is probably an unpopular opinion, but just like a lot of people would say, of course, Castlevania is kind of meant for 2D. I feel like Zelda is just best utilized in 2D.
I mean, 3D has a lot of potential, but there's too much hand-holding. I mean, Ocarina of Time did it the best, and Majora's Mask did it really, really well, too. But the ones after that, it's just like, come on, man. Just let me do my thing.
Just let me play the game. Now that I have now that I found my SP and everything, I need to play Minish Cap. Cause
Minish Cap's pretty solid.
Yeah.
I don't think I ever finished it, but it actually feels a lot like the original Zelda, but made good.
Hmm.
But the way that like the map system works and the way that it feels, it's like, oh, this is OG Zelda just modernized.
Interesting. Yeah, I'm excited to try that one out sometime.
And it shares a lot of things, like it shares like the graveyard and like.
Is this the boss? Oh yeah, right. To put the boss key. Oh crap!
I don't know why her face like turns like a dial.
Wait, so have you found other pieces of the Twilight Mirror?
Yeah, I found two of them.
Or. Do you get one? What do you get at the end of every dungeon?
This is the second one.
So you don't get one at the end of every dungeon or whatever?
No, I mean, you get 1/4 of it. So when I finished the sand dungeon, we figured out that the mirror was broken into 4 pieces, but one of the pieces was already there. And then this is the second piece.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, this boss.
Is it easy?
It's not like... easy, it's just, it's really boring. I mean, I'm doing it way worse than I did the first time.
Superb! So, what does that fam keep getting better at making it?
Yeah. You keep finding, like, random, like, food things that his wife, like, mistakenly thinks is the right, like, the key that you're looking for, but the soup gets better.
I bet you're gonna
have
to use that thing.
That's how old I am right now.
This is cool.
So actually, this part, I kind of actually want to get hit by one of these things, because all the things will be around me, so I can break them really easy. If you actually dodge them all, they're really hard to actually destroy.
I think Link's getting a nice workout by throwing that ball in chain.
Well, I think he's getting a nice workout by just rolling everywhere.
Oh, yeah. Ba-da-da-da.
I mean, you just think about the sheer amount of physical activity he's getting, and I mean, this is like in 1 hour of playtime, this is like far beyond the physical capabilities of like a regular person.
Do you think he gets the 10,000 steps that you're required per day?
Hell yeah.
I hope his pedometer says so. Nice.
So, like, when you see them all around you, you can destroy, like, 4 or 5 easily.
Oh, you broke another piece off?
Nice.
Rule of three. Show me a roll of three! So I guess normally you'd only be able to take like 1 or 2 or whatever.
Maybe 1 is It's really hard, actually.
Did you win?
That's it.
I don't like that boss.
I mean, they don't want her, you to actually hurt her because she's innocent, but it feels... It's just like, break the ice, you win.
Yeah. I guess it's just because it was so weird. So what's stopping you from freaking out because of the Twilight Mirror, just because you have Midna?
Midna takes it, yeah. And you actively try to not touch it.
Yeah, girl. Eat it. All worlds can be cruel. 10:30. Maybe you can get something set up before the next dungeon.
I actually will set up the next dungeon.
I keep getting the hankering. I guess it's because we've gotten a couple copies at the store recently to play Oracle of Ages and Seasons. But then I know that that's just a game that is just so hard. I would be like sitting there reading like a fact like a lot. I don't know.
So this is World's Greatest Love Story. Whoa.
You didn't have to tell me. I could tell.
Whoa. Wait, is that his wife?
Yeah.
She's like 1/10 his size.
That's what you get for not being a man.
Yes, sir. Do you get those hearts? Nice. Whoa. Nice. So if you pick up their hearts, is it icky?
Yes.
Ew, love hearts. I only want replenishing hearts.
Oh, so that's like the only time hearts drop in this game.
Hi, Jod. So playtime. 15:13. Dang, you played this for... You had to have grinded something
point. More than half that time.
Oh, okay.
Just doing stuff. Okay, so there's one side quest I want to show. It involves the sliding. It's fun.
Fun! In RLPs? Get out of here. We don't have fun in LPs. We have comfy time. And doom. What is it, Jack?
Oh, I'm here. I just noticed he has a horse saddle as a, like a hat.
Huh. You try, huh?
So, the first one is super duper easy. You pretty much just... You go straight and you're a lot faster than that.
Cool.
So, it's pretty much just an endurance of don't die more than win.
That makes sense. Do it.
So I'm gonna say solid song, but not on par with FF7 snowboarding track.
Yeah, definitely solid. But FF7 is FF7. It could even be a box. I like this flutey type stuff. Yo, I also got the head grin. This would be...
You took the hard path again.
Yeah, but it's fun.
I also got the hankering to play Blood Will Tell for PS2. But man, that's gonna be if that game is not as good as I remember it playing being when I played it, I'm gonna be pretty upset.
It's good, but you gotta take two things into mind. There's a lot of recoloring of bosses.
Oh yeah.
You fight
absolutely.
Bosses like
absolutely.
Four or five times. And the combat still feels solid, but there's a lot of times when it kind of feels like a Dynasty Warriors game where enemies just exist for you to beat them. But I think it's pretty fun. I think I played that one again like 2 years ago.
What a freaking unique game, and we have never had it that I know of once at the store.
It's actually while I'm in here, I'm gonna restock on soup.
Get that soup, son. Their house is still all messed up. That's cool and all.
Wait, there's still enemies in here?
I mean, you're not here to save the world, you know.
All they need is the living room, the kitchen, and their bedroom.
I would just take the kitchen with that delicious soup.
I don't know how good. So the three ingredients we gave them were: it was originally a fish stew. We gave them pumpkin, goat cheese. That's it. So I don't know how good a pumpkin fish cheese soup would be.
I'm not any bad. I'm not a big fan of pumpkin unless it's, I guess, in a sweet pie or whatever. Savory pumpkin stuff, man. I don't know.
I mean, I don't know, cheese man. Fish soup sounds delicious. I just don't know about the pumpkin.
What is it, John? Now I'm gonna go watch a freaking Let's Play, or at least some of a Let's Play of Blood Will Tell, to get me in the mood to see if I wanna try that game out again.
I don't think I've heard of that game.
So it's really, really unique. It's a PS2 game where it's like ancient Chinese or Japanese?
I think it's like Sengoku Japan.
Okay. Where the main thing about it is like 48 of your body parts of the main character are stolen. And you have to go around beating bosses to get your body parts back. And a lot of the main bosses, when you get your body parts back, you get, like, new things. Like, you would if suddenly
His body is completely weaponized. Like, his right leg is like a cannon. His two arms are blades. But as you go on, like, he wields actual blades, or he now wields a cannon or something like that.
So, like, just imagine if suddenly you got, like you were colorblind, and then suddenly got your, like, sense of, like, color, and be like, whoa. So, like, the game starts out where, if I remember correctly,
everything's
black and white, and then the first boss you beat, you get, like, your real eyesight or whatever, and then it becomes color. And then, like, not all 48 are, like, huge things. Sometimes it'll be, like, left elbow, and you get, like, a little extra strength or whatever, but like all the big bosses are like, oh, by the way, now you have your sense of hearing or whatever, and now you are
so
this much better.
This is really hard, but I did that really good. See, she was right up by.
She was right
up
next
to my butt.
So that game is so unbelievably unique, and Trevor is correct. One of the downfalls is there aren't 48. Like, unique bosses.
There's probably, like, 15.
Yeah, where you literally just fight palette swaps later in the game.
That sounds interesting, though.
I gotta do it for an LP sometime. That's one of those, like, if I had, like, a top 5 games I have to do. I already did Mario RPG and Brave Fencer Musashi. I'm doing Mega Man Legends now. That would be one of them. And then lastly, which I will never do, maybe... It's Saga Frontier. That one I would almost have to, like, do a quest and then be, like, different game.
Yeah, I feel as if doing all quests.
I mean, I would legitimately be on it for 6 months if I just
maybe
did.
Maybe do, like, red and blue and that's it?
Nah, I would save red and blue for last. I would do all 7 just over a period of time. I would go in order of least fun to most fun. I wouldn't start with loot, because loot's is too, like... I can't imagine explaining to an audience, okay, I'm going to start out with this quest that's completely open-ended, so you won't understand what the game's about. I'd probably start with Ricky, because Ricky's is pretty hand-holdy in the beginning, you know?
T26OG is pretty hand-holdy, too.
How about I like T26OG? I would save... I would do Ricky's... then Lutz, since people would understand what the game's about, then Amelia, then Acilus, then T260G, Blue, and Red.
Oh, what? Maybe you should start with Amelia, because she has that storyline about being, like, the... Like, I forget. Is she's, like, an assassin for hire or something like that?
Yeah, it's like, I think the main thing is she is
and there's
falsely
a lot of...
she's falsely convicted of murder and starts in a prison.
I think that one would be cool because it's a lot of story, but it's not like Red Tier story.
Yeah.
Well, I guess Ricky's would be the least. I just don't want to start up the thing with being like, oh, we're doing Ricky's. It's kind of good, but not as good as, like, almost all of the other ones.
I could do Amelia's first. Acilus's is too weird to start with. I don't think that's a good starter. Red's is the perfect starter, but I also want to save Red's for last because it's just pure Kino. It's just
Blues
so
is
good.
A good, like, late game one because it's almost as open as Lutz, but not quite. But a lot of times it's just, like, get magic.
Yeah. Blues is, like, I just, looking back on it, like, I just want to, like, be, like, I wish I could have, like, seen it when it was coming out and just, like, talked to them and been like, why did you not put all the stuff in you meant to do? And, like, I can't imagine, like, starting out and being like, I'm just going to pick this loot guys first. And, like, you pick it and you're like, what the crap is this game? And you hate
actually,
it for a second.
Actually, when I played the PS2 Romancing Saga, they had a character that's exactly Lute. His name's Gray. And he looked cool, and I was like, I'll pick Gray first. And he was literally Lute's quest where it's like, hey, do whatever you want.
Oh my gosh.
I walked out of the tower, the first thing I entered wrecked me. I was like, yep.
Cool. All right, guys. We will see you next time with... more Brandon. Take us out, Brandon. That's the joke.
Oh, gee,
that's the joke. We didn't say anything.